your bed. Come on. They idolize the messenger, Jesus. That's why he disowns them in Matthew 7:23. They will go to him on the day of judgment and say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not perform miracles in your name? And he'll say, out of my sight, I don't know you, get out of here. This is what Jesus will tell the Christians. And God looked down on the planet Earth and he saw you and me committing idolatry. In our contact prayer, as we're making salat prayer, we will say Muhammad Ali Muhammad, Ibrahim Ali Ibrahim. When God tells us in the Quran, very clearly, a commandment in 72:18, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. The mosque, the places of worship, the acts of worship belong to God. Do not mention anyone else. لَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. No one with God. Certainly Muhammad is someone, and Ibrahim is someone. And you and I were doing this for many years. God looked down on the planet Earth and he saw the Muslims not doing the zakat, charity. They're doing it wrong. We were doing it wrong. You and I were doing it wrong. God told us in a very clear message that you must give out the charity, the zakat, the day of harvest, the day you harvest, Surah 6, verse 141. And what were we doing? We were giving the zakat once a year, 2.5% of our savings above a certain limit. And this is what all the Muslims are doing. The zakat and salat are mentioned together. And God wanted us to get out the zakat to our parents, then our relatives. If they are rich, then to the orphans. There's a specific system in the Quran. And this must be done, according to God, the day you receive income. We do not harvest fruit. We harvest paychecks. So God wanted us to do the salam, the contact prayer correctly. He wanted us to do the zakat correctly. He wanted us to fast correctly. The ablution is wrong that we used to do, you and I. God looked down and he saw that you and I were doing the ablution wrong. 8 or 9 steps when he gave us 4 steps. God saw that everything we were doing was wrong. God looked down and he saw us associating the name of Muhammad with the name of God in the first pillar of Islam, the Shahada. And this is why this prayer of thanks. Because if someone walks through this door and said, La ilaha illallah, there is no God except the one true God, we would be very happy. You do the same thing at the Islamic Center or at any mosque in the Middle East, in Egypt, or Karachi, or Iran. Go walk in the door and say, La ilaha illallah. And they go like this. Where's the rest? Now, if you don't come up with the rest, they will literally beat you up. The great criteria is in the Quran, Surah 39, verse 45. When God alone is mentioned, the hearts of the disbelievers shrink with aversion. This is why we thank God. Because he looked down and he saw that you and me were doing it wrong. We were committing idolatry, the only unforgivable offense. God wanted us to know that we are the creatures who agreed with Satan. Long time ago, a few billion years ago, Satan violated the absolute kingship of God. He thought in his head that God can have another God besides him. Satan initiated that idea. And there are some who said, yeah, Satan can do that. He's powerful. He's got the qualifications. He can do that. Some creatures did agree with Satan. You know who those creatures are? That's you and me. God wanted us to know that. And God calls himself Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most gracious, most merciful, merciful beyond belief, our belief. So God told Satan, you go, you're doomed, because he still thinks that he can be a God besides God. But the creatures, you and I, who have been with Satan mentally, are given a second chance. This is it. God is giving us a second chance. And God wanted us to know that. God's kingdom, where all constituents of God know that God is the absolute Lord and Master, the kingdom is going from eternity to eternity. And in Surah 38, we see a dispute happening. Surah 38, قُلْ مَا كَانَ لِي مِنْ عِلْمٍ بِالْمَلَئِ الْأَعْلَى إِذْ يَخْتَصِمُونَ. Dispute. Dispute. In the high society, Satan initiated an idea. And we agreed with him. So God put us all in Adam and isolated us from that dimension. We don't remember those things because we are given a second chance to take back this idea that Satan maybe can do it. Maybe God alone is not enough, maybe. This is why associating anything with God is not forgivable. This is why we are thanking God for being born at this time when God wills that we remove all associations, that we say La ilaha illallah and we are happy with it. This is the criteria. You go in any mosque in the world and say La ilaha illallah, they will beat you up. In fact, they come in our mosque and we tell them La ilaha illallah and they want to beat us up. Now listen to this, because you can tell them that. Tell them you do not want Allah, Muhammad is not with him. And this is the truth. When you say La ilaha illallah alone, try it. Go to any mosque, any Islamic center, anywhere in the world, and say La ilaha illallah. They don't want Allah without Muhammad. I have recordings of songs from Egypt and other places that enraged Ismail, where God is a messenger of Muhammad. They pray to God to go to Muhammad and get his intercession, his shafa for them. I have it in the mosque, you can hear it.
Official theme of the religious radio.
God looked down on the planet Earth and he saw that his message, the Quran, has been tampered with. They added two verses in praise of the Prophet. What else? At the end of Surah 9. And God wanted to remove those two verses. God wanted the Quran to be pure, restored. And God wanted us to know when will the world end. It is in the Quran. And God wants to reveal it now to our generation. And we thank God for being that generation. God wanted to reveal the miracle of the Quran, an overwhelming miracle. And God wanted to tell us that our only source must be His Word, the Quran. And He did it mathematically. I'm going to share this with you, which will demonstrate the miracle and why the Quran alone. The word alone is mentioned in the Quran 6 times. It's a very limited number of mentioning. The word alone, wahdahu in Arabic, is mentioned only 6 times. 5 times are referring to God, Allah wahdahu. And 1 time is referring to the Quran, Al-Quran wahdahu, the Quran alone, okay? You look at any translation or tafsir of Quran, and they never say it, Al-Quran wahdahu. They tell you that this wahdahu alone refers to Rabbaka, to your Lord, to God, not to the Quran. Because it's a doctrine from God. It says you follow the Quran alone, and they don't want to do that. So they distort it. Now listen to the mathematics that God put in the Quran. If you take the surah and the verses where the word alone is mentioned, the total is 19 times 19, 361. These are the 5 alone that refer to God. If you take the one referring to the Quran, this destroys the criteria. It is not a multiple of 19 anymore. And this proves that alone in Surah 17 refers to the Quran alone. Linguistically, it is referring to the Quran. It came after the Quran. It says when you preach about God in the Quran alone, they turn away in aversion. They run away in aversion. And now God could have said, when you preach God alone in the Quran, they run away in aversion, but he didn't do it that way. He put the word alone after the Quran, and this is supported, as you see, mathematically. So God wanted to establish this fact, that religious teaching must come from the Quran and the Quran alone, nothing else. God wanted us to believe that he is doing everything. Now this is a very difficult concept. But we find it in Surah 8, verse 17. 8:17 is the Muslim 19. And it says, it is not you who threw when you threw, it is God who threw. The Quran, in about 100 verses, tells us people who believe that he is the Lord of the universe, the Lord of the great throne, these people are going to hell. Why? Because they do not believe that God is doing everything. This doctrine that God wants us to know sheds a whole new light on the concept of submission. Because if you know that God is doing everything, you will not object. You will never be unhappy. You will not object to anything. You will be a Muslim. You will be a submitter. This is what Muslim is. God wanted us to know that Muhammad wrote the Quran with his hand, that he was not an illiterate man, a ridiculous concept. They were looking for a miracle of Quran the wrong way. And they thought, if we say that Muhammad is illiterate, he cannot read or write, this will make him a fantastic miracle. So they lie about their idol. He wrote the Quran with his hand. We have the proof, and God wanted us to know that. God wants us to know that the Masjid al-Aqsa, the Aqsa Mosque, is not in Jerusalem. It is in the seventh heaven, in the seventh universe. And wants us to know that Muhammad went there and received the Quran over there. And God wanted us to know the secret of perfect happiness. We're going to go into all details for all of these. On page 69 of Rabbi Kushner's book, he said, I don't know why people are mortal and fated to die. And I don't know why people die at the time and in the way they do. Perhaps you can try to understand it by picturing what the world would be like if people lived forever. Of course, God can do that if he so will. But we know the reason why we came to this world and why the human being dies. But for all these reasons, God tells us in the Quran that after all the prophets have come, in Surah 3, verse 81, God will send a messenger who will confirm all the prophets and restore all their messages to their pristine purity. Now, do we believe in the Quran? Do we believe in the Quran? If we believe in the Quran, we would believe this verse, 81 and Surah 3. And as most of you are aware, that some person in South Africa wrote an article saying that the messenger who will come and confirm all the prophets is Muhammad. This person fell in a trap of his ignorance, because in Surah 33 God says that it is not Muhammad. That Muhammad was one of the prophets who made the covenant and the pledge with God to believe and support and help the messenger who will come after all the prophets. So, if we believe that verse, we have to ask ourselves, who is this messenger? What does he look like? How about Ronald Reagan? I mean, we have to be open-minded. I mean, just imagine, how about your uncle? Think of your uncle, think of the brother of your father, for example. See, we have to be open-minded, because as Parivash read the verses that says they swore solemnly by God that if a warner came to them, They will be better guided. They will treat him better. Then when the owner came, this increased their aversion because of their arrogance. Because the human nature, when you say, this human being is God's messenger, the human nature, unless we overcome the ego, will be averse to that idea. But we must be open to that. And we just have to ask the person, what is your proof? The Quran says that. The Quran says, Hatu Burhanakum. Bring your proof. So I'm going to close with this, that we must be open to the idea that God told us in the Quran. It is very clear, and there are many, many places in the Quran that will explain it and make it very clear to us. I want to introduce all of you to each other, and would you carry the camera on your shoulder, Kat? We're going to start with Raymond, the one and only. No, check the camera itself, easier. Unless it's easier for you. All right. Let's go. Raymond comes from Vancouver. He is one of the original survivors, and with the very first fights where they sent warriors from Saudi Arabia to come and combat us. Vancouver, BC. Next to him is Ahmed Barouni. He's very shy. We love him very much. He's, without him, we cannot make the Tama of Salah. No, it's all right. No, no, you can see him.
No, no.
Okay, wait for a minute.
Stand up. Right.
Hamid.
Everybody knows.
My brother-in-law, Ahmed Rayan. MashaAllah. Very strong believer. Brother Abdul Muta'al came all the way from New York.
Salam.
And Brother Azzedine came with his sister-in-law, Naima Turner. He's testing the water. Wants to find out what the truth is. And he strives, comes all the way from California. Brother Mahmoud Mohini, God bless him, is a strong member of Masjid Tusa. Oh, Farhad Mohini, excuse me. Farhad Mohini. Brother Hussein Kausari, I discouraged him, but he came in spite of all discouragement.
At 1:30, I'm supposed to give thanks to God and congratulations to you. And I think this will be my chance to, so maybe you can finish early. There are some people who are trying to catch planes. So I expect, inshallah, to just have lunch, eat and run. You know, after we have lunch, we'll just be.
Let's do
that.
Let's do that.
Well, let me start with congratulating you, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw us heading for a conference, absolutely the greatest collection of people who worship God alone and uphold the word of God alone. There is no question that this is a very special spot in the universe. And you will agree with me that there are angels that are full of excitement roaming around us here. And also, I have to go to the book of Job and quote a few examples from there, where Satan told God, why shouldn't Job worship you? He's happy, he's content, everything is going right for him. If I touch his properties, he blasphemes against you. And God told Satan, okay, you can go and touch his property, but you cannot touch him. God puts limits on Satan. So Satan went and destroyed all of Job's properties. And Job continued to worship God alone. Didn't make any difference. And you know the rest of the story.
Can you hang on?
And I fix this.
Okay. Wait, I got it.
These people are not strong. you give them just a little bit of trouble, they will turn around and go back. And God told Satan, okay, you can have them within limits. Give them some confusion and some overheating cars and let them get lost. Should be recited this way or not? The way very much this beautiful recitation of the Quran. Well, when the discussion with the Azhar seems to be really like I called it before, a castle of Satan. And we had the rest of Al-Azhar faith before our eyes. But anyway, we had a discussion with him. He disagreed with the way the Quran is recited by Fairy Bash, for example, or the other reciters. Fagila demonstration is the way he wants the Quran to be recited. It's a very repulsive, ugly recitation. And in his opinion, he thinks, get some sujood marks. He thinks that the Quran should be recited in that way. And so, anyway, we had a big discussion, and somebody asked the extreme question, how about adding music to the Quran? I mean, what's wrong with anything that would make us listen to the Quran and learn the Quran and understand the word of God? That was said jokingly. And then, the very first morning after that, and we were guests at my brother's house, where he has some beautiful flowers with the landscaping outside, so Kat wanted to take some pictures of the flowers with the video to use as background for our video programs. And it just happened that Perry Rash was passing by, and Kat said, why don't I have you recite some Quran while I'm shooting the flowers? Perry Rash came and started reciting in the most beautiful, heavenly recitation that you can hear, for example, at the beginning of the videotape called The Great Debate. Some of you did hear it. Perry Rash started to read the Quran, and soon enough, a bird came and provided, God provided music. Whenever Perry Rash read the Quran, the bird read the Quran with him. It was just beautiful harmony. And an absolute miracle, one of the things that we witnessed. Okay? Maybe that was a coincidence. Outside right now, Brother Abdul Muta'al from New York, he wants to take his collecting mementos of the conference, souvenirs, to take back to New York. And very much happened to be passing by as he was holding his recorder, right? So he asked very much, please come and recite some Quran for my recorder. You know something? A bird. Did you ever hear? Did you hear any birds this morning? I don't know. A bird showed up and started singing along with Perry Bash. It is not. It is not as pronounced or profound like the videotape. You're going to see something. But here is the evidence, folks. Not as the bird, it is not as pronounced as the other one, but it is there, and it's a confirmation, absolute confirmation of that.
This is very special, like everybody. I'm very glad that I'm here for convention. Congratulations to all of you who, alhamdulillah, worship God alone and follow Quran alone, and really congratulations for being, inshallah, all united together, alhamdulillah. Now one verses in the Quran, ربنا لا تطع قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. That means, our Lord, let not our hearts falter after being guided by you, and show us with your mercy. You are the granter, alhamdulillah. We are very happy here because we worship God alone, and we are really, really very lucky generation. God bless you all, inshallah.
This young lady has a sprouting voice. I tell you, I'm trying to get some of it on the tape so that
okay.
You can hear it.
Now, okay. Come on. Yeah, it's beautiful, Sky.
What? Quran is wisdom. Just the subtitle provokes a short discussion here, because people who are trying very hard to go to hell, people are storming the gates of hell and digging tunnels under the fence to go to hell, say that Quran is the scripture and hadith is the wisdom. Because God says in the Quran consistently, scripture and wisdom. And God says this to every prophet, Jesus, Moses, Muhammad. But of course they lose sight of this. And in this verse here, 39, we are told that Quran is wisdom. When you acquire Quran, you acquire wisdom. Before this one, are giving us a list of commandments, which are include the Ten Commandments. You shall not kill, you shall honor your parents. Of course, the first commandment, you shall worship God alone. And then now comes verse 39, which says, this is some of the wisdom inspired to you by your Lord. You shall not set up another God beside God, lest you end up in Gehenna, blamed and defeated. So, if you can make a mental picture in your mind, when these people tell you that the hadith is the wisdom, remember this 1739. The 1739 is a clear statement that Quran is the wisdom. Verse 40 says, has your Lord given you boys while giving himself the angels as daughters? How could you utter such a blasphemy? We have cited in this Quran all kinds of examples that they may take heed, but it only augments their aversion. There is a tendency among especially the Arabs of those days, and even now, and some other nationalities, a prejudice to baby boys. Before the baby is born, they want a boy. this is their wish. But at the risk of being prejudiced against boys, I say girls are better than boys. Just to counter that, general erroneous bigoted trend. But it seems like when we have sons and daughters, when the sons get married, we lose them. But when the daughters get married, we gain a son-in-law. This seems to be a general trend. So to correct the biased statement just made, I say when the boys make it and become believers, they're wonderful. But the girls definitely have an advantage as far as God is concerned in that God created the man with more ego. And this is a real problem. I mean, this is why when we have boys and they are believers, they're wonderful. When we have girls and they're believers, they're fantastic. So this bigoted principle is very wrong, of course. The Quran condemns it in the strongest terms. In Surah 16, for example, the surah before this one, as to how they react to a baby boy or a baby girl. The Quran condemns their prejudice. 41, we have cited in this Quran all kinds of examples that they may take heed, but it only augments their aversion. 42, say, if there were other gods beside him, as they claim, they would have tried to overthrow the possessor of the throne. So God is discussing it in logical terms. If we had three gods, they will overthrow each other until one of them dominates. Anyway. Taid, why are you hiding? Come back here. You have a Quran? No, you can come here and be cozy. We want everybody to see you. We're exhibiting Taid. Get a copy of the Quran, my friend.
Can you get a picture too?
Why not?
Yeah.
Yeah. Here, open page 286. Verse 43 says, Be he glorified, he is much too exalted, far above their utterances. Their utterances cause mountains to shatter. Because it's like putting a virus next to you. Of course, it's much more than that. The proportion is much more than that. When they say that a virus is your partner in this business, for example. The vice president of Islamic University in Medina tells us, you have only God there, that's all, on the wall. He wants Muhammad next to God. Is that all? Can you imagine? I mean, made me cringe. That was the end of the conversation. Really, it makes you cringe. Is that all? I mean, he's talking about God. Is that all? This is why verse 43 says, Be he glorified, he is much too exalted, far above their utterances. I mean, you and I are going to meet this man on the day of judgment. We'll see how he can repeat that question. Is that all, he says. 44. Glorifying him are the seven universes, the earth, and everyone in them. There is nothing that does not glorify him. But you do not comprehend the glorification. He is clement, forgiver. Even the disbelievers glorify God unwillingly. Because their heart beats, they cannot change the number of their heart beats, or the way their intestines, the peristalsis works. They cannot control any of that, their body. Glorifying him are the seven universes, the earth and everything in them. There is nothing that does not glorify him, but you do not comprehend the glorification. He is clement, forgiver. We went through the fact that this wall glorifies God, the carpet, this tape recorder, because every atom has molecules and has nuclei and electrons and neutrons, and protons, and they're all moving in precise orbits according to God's law. This is how they glorify God. they never deviate, never. Otherwise, all of a sudden, this book will become gold or something. Or lead, you know. Don't say, I wish it is or something. Because it can turn to lead. Just, and the text, minor change in the electrons, the numbers of the orbits of the electrons. There is nothing that does not glorify God.
Well, it is gold.
The invisible barrier. The invisible barrier explains your experiences when you're talking to the people, giving them very strong proof, and they don't move. It doesn't reach them. When you read the Quran, we place between you and those who do not believe in the hereafter an invisible barrier. This is one of three important criteria that tells us whether we believe in the hereafter or not. You and I claim to believe in the hereafter, but that doesn't mean a thing. When we claim with our mouth that we believe in the hereafter, it doesn't mean a thing. You have to pass these three criteria. This is one of them. When you read the Quran, we place between you and those who do not believe in the hereafter an invisible barrier, and we place shields around their minds to prevent them from understanding the Quran, and deafness in their ears. And when you preach your Lord using the Quran alone, they run away in aversion. So there's the criteria. If you tell them Quran alone and they're averse to this idea, this means they do not believe in the hereafter, no matter what they say with their mouth. The other criteria is the same number of verse, 45, but in Surah 39. You want to look at it? Surah 39. It's a very simple criteria that we can apply to ourselves and to the people we talk to. It's 463, verse 45. I call it the greatest criteria. It says, when God alone is mentioned, the hearts of those who do not believe in the hereafter shrink with aversion. But when others are mentioned beside him, they rejoice. Yusuf Ali outright refused to translate this verse correctly. He refused to use the word alone, which he translated correctly in other places in the Quran. But when it came to when God alone is mentioned, they become averse, he became averse. And he changed alone to the one and only. Which doesn't mean anything, doesn't mean alone. Because the one and only means the great, the gracious, the merciful, the one and only. But alone is a very specific word. And Yusuf Ali refused to, you can see the other translations squirm around it and try to avoid saying it. Because they apply the criterion to themselves and they don't pass. It proves that they do not believe in the hereafter, which is a prerequisite for going to heaven. So this is the criterion. When you talk to someone and you tell them God alone, or you just talk about God alone, and they tell you you're a kafir, which is a very funny statement. You tell them, La ilaha illallah, you say you're a kafir. What? I'm saying worship God alone. You call me I'm a kafir because I say God alone. Ihsan always answers them, says, Kafarna bi shirkukum. Said, yes, I'm a kafir of your shirk. For idolatry, which is a statement in Surah 60. It's a very funny statement. You tell the most of God alone, say you're a kafir. A kafir of what?
I mean, the people that we know,
Right. I mean,
just
one time,
actually, one
month only.
You still
with those group, the one that worship God alone? Right. Did you hear what you're saying? Al-Muwahideen, yes. Al-Muwahideen. Naima, Ihsan developed a very good idea. It's going to help you when you argue with those lobsters. She was arguing with an Egyptian fellow in Canada. And she told them that when you say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, among the commandments you break is the commandment of making distinction among the messengers. You should not make distinction among the messengers. So she asked him,
When was the last time you said La ilaha illallah Salih Rasulullah? He said, just because I don't say Salih Rasulullah doesn't mean I don't believe he's Rasulullah. She said, exactly. Just because we don't say Muhammad Rasulullah doesn't mean we don't believe that Muhammad is Rasulullah. Yeah. I mean, he just fell in the trap very nicely. Yeah. We have it. We have the conversation recorded. There are a few other ideas that will come. So here, now we saw two criteria. The one in verse 45 of Surah 17, 45-46, which says Quran alone. When you say the Quran alone and they become averse to it, this tells them and tells you and will bear witness on them on the day of judgment that they did not believe in the hereafter. If somebody tells me Quran alone and I don't like it, this tells me that I don't believe in the hereafter, even if I'm saying it with my mouth. I can swear by God that I believe in the hereafter. But if I'm not content with the Quran alone, I'm a liar. This is a criterion. Now, the third criterion is in 6113. And this is in page 142. You start at 112. It says, Hadith and Sunnah, fabrications by the Prophet's enemies. And accepting them, again, is a criterion for disbelief in hereafter. Because 112 says, we also set up enemies against every prophet. And this, of course, includes the Prophet Muhammad. Human and jinn devils who inspire in each other fancy words. Another description of hadith. In order to deceive, had your Lord willed, they would not have done it. You shall disregard them and their fabrications. So why did God will that they fabricate those things? In 113 it says, this is to let the minds of those who do not believe in the hereafter, see, this is the common denominator here, disbelief in the hereafter, listen to such fabrications and accept them, and thus expose the real convictions. Because with their mouth they say, we believe in the hereafter. But if they accept any source besides the Quran as their source for religious guidance, this is the criterion that tells me, tells them, that they do not believe in the hereafter. So the first two criteria are really the same thing, but in two different ways. One of them, if you accept a source other than the Quran, you don't. Those and their families on the day of resurrection. Most certainly, this is the worst loss. Losing the soul is literal. When we don't pray, we don't worship God alone, the soul shrinks. Not only to zero, it goes to negative. Just be full of negative charges. Losing their souls and their families. Because a soul that is shrunk is repulsed by everything else. Do you remember those movies about gambling and the Old West and drinking and shooting and killing? Murders, fighting, shooting and killing are always associated with the places of gambling and drinking. Because the souls are so shrunk, there's so much hate. Yeah, it's amazing how they show those movies and they have poker hands or something, and they focus on the faces, and so there's so much hatred and cheating and money grabbing,
greed,
and then they shoot each other. They're reaching for their guns, you know, every few minutes.
they have their guns on their lap, actually.
Yes, exactly.
They play poker or on the table. Right. And whiskey.
Yes. Gambling and drinking.
In France, for instance, they show these films, of all the films they show in 1 week in France. There are so many killings and murders, and it's only this.
That was Murder Week or something?
No, the movies. Every week.
Oh, every week.
Yeah, it's nothing but that.
Yeah. It affects the people.
Of course.
16. They will have masses of fire on top of them and under them. God thus alerts his servants, O my servants, you shall reverence me. As for those who discarded the worship of all idols and devoted themselves totally to God, they have the good news. Give good news to my servants. They are the ones who examine all words, then follow the best. These are the ones whom God has guided. These are the ones who possess intelligence. For those who have incurred the retribution, can you save those who are already in hell? As for those who reverence the Lord, they will have mansions upon mansions constructed for them with flowing streams. This is God's promise, and God never breaks His promise. Do you not see that God sends down from the sky water, then places it into underground wells, then produces with it plants of various colors, then they grow until they turn yellow and become hay? This should be a reminder for those who possess intelligence. I think I'll stop here and have general discussions if there's any.
By interruption here, by Malkan, is any devil, Shaitan, is any action here or any? For example, Malkan, but they cause interruption. I make me a little nervous, I can understand my prayer.
Say it again, start all over again.
Okay. Malkan, but they cause, it makes me nervous, my son, Muhammad. So, he interrupts really and makes me nervous, I can understand.
Oh, because Muhammad is making noise?
Yeah.
That's natural.
Is Shaitan has any
yes.
Power?
Yes, he scares you and makes you nervous. You need to relax. Concentrate on that. Don't worry, he's in God's hand.
Yeah.
In the Kaddish, it's very kind of life. Yes.
Does the jinn that you were born with, and that was used as a companion, as an early child, can he already start when you're too young to really understand and understand the Quran? Already starts to influence his views of Satan? Not like taking cookies from the cookie jar, but stuff like there's no God, and already starts.
Yes, that would be from Satan. It has to do with God. But remember that the jinn is also a baby at the time you're a baby.
Oh.
Yes. Our qualities as humans are not really complete. We grow in our human qualities, and so does the jinn. He also grows in his jinn qualities.
So mischievousness in children is when the jinn is in control.
No, I didn't say that. I said the exact opposite. Said that when they're children, the jinn is also children.
Yeah.
It's not an adult jinn getting hold of a child.
No, I heard.
Jinn also is a child.
Yeah, but I mean,
it's directly proportionate. That's what you're
saying. Yeah. You mean to the age?
Parallel.
Yes. As soon as the human being begins to reason, so will the jinn. And he will, for example, he will tell you, as of now, don't get up early in the morning to do the morning prayer. It's more fun to sleep, he'll tell you. He'll even keep you from school homework. He'll make it boring for you. You know, it's really crazy. The jinn tells us the things that are bad for us. Don't they realize that if I starve, he'll starve too? You know? Because they share in our pain and our joys.
In other words, there are as many jinns as human beings.
No, as many companions as human beings. Every human being is two. A human being and a companion. A human being and a companion.
Now,
jinns are the freed companions. There are many more of those.
But Satan must be really stupid, because he wants to prove that he's competent.
Yes.
But basically, he's just proving the opposite all the time. Willingly.
How?
Well, he should be as smart to see that his ways are destructive, that they don't lead anywhere. So why can't he have enough intelligence and draw the conclusions that...
Because he's still hoping that he can fix everything.
Just
he's
like,
still hoping. Yeah.
Just like the perestroika. He has a continuous perestroika.
Right. Yes, very good analogy.
Can you say, just to understand a little bit what he is saying, right now it's just 10% of the population. If I understood the right time, it says the earth is populated just 10% of the global...
the total human population, yes.
So he thinks he still has a lot of time to catch up.
Yes, he's still hoping that he will fix everything. But things keep popping up. Just as he takes care of polio, for example, AIDS comes up. And he's working on AIDS and so on. So it's like somebody who's guarding a wall or a dam that has leaks in it. I always give this analogy. And he puts his finger in the hole to stop the water, but another leak comes up and puts the other hole. It seems like right now he's got all 10 fingers and 10 toes.
He's running out of
fingers. Yes, running out of fingers and toes. Yeah. This is the purpose of that system of increasing the population. For example, how come AIDS didn't show up 1,000 years ago? There were homosexuals 1,000 years ago. So why didn't AIDS show up then? Can you guess? Why do we have AIDS now and not 1,000 years ago? Where did it come from?
Well, they become so vocal now and so violent about it. They allow us to... They become very open.
Just because of the state.
Let's give Muhammad a chance to think. Hold on. Could you keep the children apart? Call your child next to you.
Mark on.
Annie, come here. Come here. The only way to keep him quiet is to keep him apart. Good boss. Yes. Hanan, come next to mom. Okay, where do you prefer to sit? In that chair over there? You prefer to sit in that chair? No? Okay, you pick out a good spot. What's the best spot? Where you are? Okay. Okay, Muhammad. Get his attention away from that.
Like if they during the Romans, the whole empire collapsed mostly because of their wrongdoing. They have other diseases. The population was small.
Yes.
So very small population. So we give him just a test of what he tried to make a perfect world with the Romans. For instance, if you take the Roman Empire, that the general idea is just like in the communists, as long as it's on the paper, it's fantastic. It has to stay in the paper. And they try to, they put some applications.
Did it work?
The whole thing is collapsed.
Yeah.
And,
my feeling is that AIDS, okay, when 1,000 years ago, the population of the earth was very small, and Satan was able to handle that. But now that the population increased, he's losing control. So we get all the starving children in Africa and AIDS. So things are getting out of control for him. And if I get a chance in the next few days, maybe. We had examples here of Satan's incompetence, where we have proof that his ability to see is very limited. I mean, God sees everything in the universe. Not a single atom is out of God's control. But we have very strong evidence that Satan's control is very limited, and he cannot. He has very serious limitations with seeing.
By the way. He needs to conclude the wrong theory, I'll say the wrong point. If Satan wants to prevent starvation and all AIDS, scientists, for example, to try to find a cure for AIDS, or people, charitable people who try to, help starving people, do they help Satan to make it better?
He helps them, Satan is trying very hard to make everything perfect.
I know that, for example, if we help a starving children,
yes.
Starving children. Do you have Satan by this way? We shouldn't help starving people.
No, you help because that's your requirement, but it doesn't make any difference. That as far as Satan is concerned.
If you try to have a good world or have a good, for example, state, whatever, if to be good is state an object,
your zakat or your contribution is insignificant. Do not counteract the damage that Satan is doing by his incompetence. Do not correct it. But it is my duty and your duty to give zakat and to be charitable. And this is in Surah 36. أَنُطَرْ مَنْ لَوَ شَاءُ اللَّهُ أَطْعَمَكُ. This is what the unbelievers will say. You want me to feed somebody that God wants to starve? God wants him to starve. Why should I feed him? This is what he's saying. But that's not...
I think in God's dominion, things will go bad. Yeah, good. Things will go good, but in Satan's dominion, people...
Things will go bad.
Yeah, go bad. Yes. Satan would want to make it good.
Right. Satan is stuck by us to make it good.
Let me
mention it now and very quickly, anyway. The miracle of Quran, which is a fantastic finding at this time, came out of Satan's pocket. It was hidden in his pocket. Because this is a long story. I'm going to have to make it short without doing it injustice. That I was working for Monsanto Company. And then I had to give a paper at the American Chemical Society meeting in Chicago, 1970. And after I gave the paper, this gentleman approaches me and he says, he's the research director for Anheuser-Busch. Same city where I was working. I was working for Monsanto in St. Louis. Anheuser-Busch is the biggest brewery in the world. Produces more alcohol than any place in the world. Drink for drinking, beer. And he came and he said, we would like you to work for us. So I laughed. I said, no way, I can't work for Anheuser-Busch. He says, why? I said, because I'm a Muslim and I can't deal with alcohol. He said, this position has nothing to do with alcohol. You're going to be in the food technology section, the food research section, and it has nothing to do with alcohol, it has to do with yeast, baker's yeast and brewer's yeast and so on. I said, I will be connected with the name of Anheuser-Busch, and this is something I don't want to be connected with the name of Anheuser-Busch. And he said, then he started from another angle. He said, what we're trying to do is, in the world, there are millions of tons of yeast and other agricultural waste that we throw away, and it's full of protein. If you can help us, get this protein out and turn it into food, those starving people in your country and back in Africa will not be starving. So he's trying to use a humanitarian thing. I mean, it was really persistent. We must reverence God all the time. I mean, people will be driving and in a minute they get in an accident and they're gone. Or that he will not send upon you a tempest, then you will find no protector. Have you guaranteed that he will not return you to the sea and send upon you a storm that drowns you because of your disbelief without getting a second chance? We have honored the children of Adam and carried them on land and in the sea. We provided for them good provisions and we honored them high above many of our creatures. The day will come when we summon every people together with their record. As for those who are given a record of righteousness, they will read the record and will not suffer the least injustice. As for those who are blind in this life, they will be blind in the hereafter, even a lot worse. They almost diverted you from the commandments we revealed to you. They wanted you to fabricate something else in order to consider you a friend. If it were not that we strengthened you, you almost leaned towards them a little bit. Had you done that, we would have doubled the retribution for you in this life and after death, and you would have found no one to help you against us. So you can see the responsibility of, if you're in a position to be asked a question, you have a great responsibility to give the correct answer. You cannot acquiesce to the people or play into their wishes. You have to give them the word of God and without any delusion or deviation because of this verse 75. Had you done that, we would have doubled the retribution for you in this life and after death, and you would have found no one to help you against us. So there's too much at stake. So if they want to talk you into lying some white lies, say absolutely not. Don't lie. No white lies. So we're going to stop at this and open the floor for questions.
Satan is envious of us.
Yes, because some of us have hope to be redeemed back to God's kingdom. Satan has no hope. So he's envious. He wants to take as many of us as he can with him.
God praises children of Adam and says, and we honor them high above many of our creatures. In other words, we see God says that human beings are stupid and they are wicked. And here there is honor and praise.
Well, if you take a wicked person, he still can ride a horse. The horse is much better than the person, but this is who is honored. This is what this means, and especially that it talks about carrying people on the. See, حملناهم في البر والبحر. We carried them, we provide them with rides, and we honor them above many of our creatures. You can see lions in the cage, but you don't see a human being in a cage in the lion country. You go visit lion country, you will not find a human being in a cage and the lion looking at the human. Even though the lion is much stronger. This is honoring the human being. God gave us the mind, so we abuse them by setting traps for the animals and catching them, putting them in the zoo. We ride the horse. Use them as pets. You can feed them anytime you want to. Notice that we feed the cats, not the other way around. Yeah? They try. Can't blame them. Sometimes it works.
Rasha, there is another point here. In Arabic, وفضلناهم على كثير
من خلقنا
تفضيلا. This is man, not smart. It means above others. Is man must include something that human being or angel.
Oh, you can call the animals men also. ممن خلقنا تفضيلا. In this particular context, this particular structure, grammatical structure. Sometimes God says, لِلَّهِ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And some says, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Sometimes man applies to inanimate objects.
Satan knew that he could not control, possess all his descendants. He said, I will possess them, not except for a few. He knew that.
Not the gods. The people who step into God's protection, Satan cannot touch them.
Can Satan have protection? Every day the constant push by Satan to try to make the wrong decision.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. His main targets are the believers.
You have Fatma.
But when you make a decision, say Bismillah or Rahman or Rahim, still you can be talking
about. He's waiting for you to make a mistake, to step out. He's waiting for you to step out so he can beat you up. You step out by missing a prayer, for example. Then you're vulnerable. And God puts precise limits on him as far as if you miss a prayer, you're supposed to get in trouble. Satan can only do so much because of the limits. Remember, I said if you forget to say Bismillah when you get up in the morning, when you forget to mention the name of God as the first thing you do in the morning, this will cost you $75 to put a dollar value on it. So in other words, God tells Satan you can only bother him to the amount of $75, but that's it. So if you don't have it, it'll give you a small headache, a little annoyance,
or a flat tire.
Flat tire.
No wonder that actually that the majority of the people are against Islam.
Why?
Well, it's obvious that because they don't like it. The law is too strict.
On the contrary.
No, but in the eyes of the people, they perceive it as being...
Yes. Actually, this is a sign of the true religion. It's if you look at the different Christian sects today, they acquiesce to the people's wishes. What is the book of the Seventh-day Adventists, for example? They must have their own specific rules. Or the Christian Scientists, or the Quakers, or the Amish, or the Unitarians. What is their book that they go by, a book of rules? Do they have a book of rules? The Catholics, what is the book of the Catholics? Why did they eat fish on Friday 20 years ago, but not anymore? Which book says, do not eat meat on Friday, and then now it says, eat meat on Friday? So they acquiesce to the people's wishes. The objective is to get as many people in this church as possible. So that's a sign of a false religion, false doctrine.
No.
Church of Christ?
Yeah.
Which one?
The
no, but the Mormons also call themselves Church of Christ. And that's what they say. Yeah, don't be tricked. Yeah, this. If you dig just a little bit beneath the surface, you'll see them idolizing Jesus and Mary and the saints.
Yeah.
Well, if they think Jesus is God, the Son of God, they already deviated from the Bible. Because, what do? They say Jesus is God, the Son of God? Yeah, the Trinity, right? That's not in the Bible.
Well, no, they don't believe in Trinity. One program that was
in the Trinity. So they say He's the Father and the Son?
He calls God the Father.
Oh, He calls God the Father and Jesus the Son. No, I mean, what do they believe in? That's fine. They can do that as long as God is the Father of all the righteous. Father to all.
They say it started in the Philippines, and it's now.
Well, see, the name itself indicates idol worship. It's not the Church of God. If it's the Church of God, then we have to go a little deeper and see what the principle. But right from the title, if it's the Church of Christ, then they are attached themselves to a human factor. They're in trouble from the title.
Because one time they had a program about the dice setting, you know,
yeah. Yeah. See, if the name is the Church of God, which is the name of one of the churches, then you have to move on to the next line. But the first line says the Church of Christ, then it's, that's it. You don't follow the Bible, please, because The Bible says that Jesus is not God and not the Son of God, not the only Son of God anyway. And this is in all the Bibles of all denominations, Catholic, Protestant, in John 20:17, where Jesus says, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. Finished. This kills the Trinity right there. And this is consistent with the rest of the text. I'm not just taking one verse. Because in addition to this, the whole context of the New Testament agrees with this. And nowhere does it say Jesus is God. He doesn't say, I am God. He may say, I'm the light and the life and the first and the last and then the net, but never says, I'm God. Why doesn't he? Go ahead. I know. True. That's, even if you take that, the thing that he is. At the beginning there was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, but this means Jesus is God. But it doesn't say that. I mean, they just take you into a roundabout way, and then they come up with a conclusion that has nothing to do with the statement in the Bible. But the truth is, nowhere in the Bible does it say Jesus is God. And three of the Gospels never say that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. Only once in the Gospel of John does it say that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, and that verse happens to be questionable now by the annual convention called the Jesus Conference. Please get your children to be next to you. Separate them from each other. Maha, come here, honey.
Tanya.
Honey, come here. Maha. Honey, come here. Come here. Maha, come here. Good girl. Nice and quiet for 19 seconds. Yes.
How do you interpret then Jesus' words when he was dying on the cross and he said to his to God, Father, Father, why have thou forsaken me?
No, he said, my God, my God. They even put it in his language, Eloi, Eloi, Elahi, Elahi.
Did that say Father, Father?
No, he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? You probably read it Father, Father in some other translation, but that's not, because they put it in Aramaic. In all the Gospels, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? It means he's not God, right? For one thing. The truth is, he never said that. Just to compound the problem. We know now that he never said that. But if he said it according to them, it means he's not God.
So then he never said that because he had already died, right?
Because he was not there.
Right.
His body was alive, but he was not there. That was a body that did not respond to anything. Pardon?
Yes, he didn't suffer.
No.
No. But how come that these people can believe that he is God?
What's it next to Daddy?
How come that they can believe?
Who?
That Jesus is actually God.
You're right. That's the...
It's so contradictory.
Exactly. See, Satan wants to point at us and say, look how stupid they are. Yeah. I think Satan is hoping that so many humans will out Satan, that God will have mercy on Satan. Yes, quite a few people out Satan. I have a few examples. In other words, Satan told them something and they went too far in doing it. So Satan said, whoa, I didn't tell you to do all this.
But he says in the Quran that I know what you don't know, you know, I'm giving you something.
For example, I can give you an example.
Yes. Pardon?
I can give you an example.
Yeah, go ahead.
Satan doesn't deny God's existence.
Right.
But communists, there they go further.
That's right. Yes, if you have two things. There are two things that come from Satan, fear and worry. Fear and grief. Worry, worry or fear and grief. Well, anger comes, but God says the believers suppress their anger. So anger happens, but you control it. But remember, throughout the Quran, you know this very well, that God says, لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. No fear, no grief. Two things. Yeah, this is the suppressor. The believer suppress anger. Yes. So anger happens, but you control it. Part of training our wild horse. Anger is part of the wild horse that we are training. But really, this is a very good criteria to remind us whether we are believers or not. If we have fear, worry, or grief. And God spelled this out in the Quran. God says that fear is Satan's tool with which he does it to his constituents. This is why insurance agents are probably very close to Satan. What happens if you die tomorrow? What will happen to your family? Huh? Yes. Accidental death insurance. Insurance is all based on fear.
So it means that emotions could have fear, but as soon as the fear comes, it's coming from Satan that you have to sort of get rid of it.
You don't have fear.
You don't have fear at
all. Satan will try to put worry in your heart, but what I'm saying is Satan is the source of these two things, worry and grief. When you grieve over anything, you're objecting to God, what God did. God is doing everything.
Is
fear
from cockroaches included?
Yes, absolutely. Fear of cockroaches. Adip is definitely afraid of cockroaches.
shouldn't go to be an employee for the insurance company.
I'll avoid it. I'll avoid that.
If I open a store, a variety of store, like K, some or 7-Eleven, I shouldn't sell any beer or something like that.
Right. I'd avoid it. Yes?
Would ODIs, come
to Yep. Believers have no phobias. The believers know that not a scratch will touch you if you're in God's protection. Not a scratch. So there'll be no phobia, don't be afraid.
You can conquer your
Yes. You conquer your phobia.
But most of it is unconscious, isn't it?
Yeah, with conscious or unconscious, your conscious being will convince your unconscious being that there is no reason to be afraid since no scratch will happen to you. God puts in the strongest terms in the Quran that there are guards around you. You are being guarded. In Arabic, وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ. These are two assurances. وَإِنَّ لَا. إِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ. You are guarded very well by God's guards. So that they see to it that not a scratch comes to you against God's will. Oh yeah, it's a long drawn process. It's a difficult, not easy. But you see, once we apply for admission into God's kingdom, there's a process that takes place, purification process, education. As long as we do our homework, this is the textbook. This is the manual. And test. Yeah. That's right.
I'm going to share with you, with your permission, just an experience. Before you said the Arab, and out of the boundary of God. A few months ago, I was I put those machines in the place, and I was driving. It's a story I really have difficult to understand when I put it in Arab. In English, it's different, but when you listen to it enough, and then suddenly I start to understand the word. It's very easy because the word in Arab, the Quran word is not corrupted. The understanding of the Arab is corrupted.
Yes.
So then you have the barrier, and then I think that's what happened.
Yes, well, of course, there is God's law that says an insincere person cannot touch the Quran, cannot get one word out of it. But the sincere searcher, even a disbeliever, or a Muslim, or a Jew, or a Christian, as long as the person sincerely seeking the truth, it will be open to that person. Otherwise, they cannot, they're blocked out. They can be professors of Arabic language at the Islamic University of Mecca, and they cannot get one single letter out of the Quran. I've seen many people who have memorized the Quran for many, many years. They never lost it, but they didn't believe anything in it. They didn't have access to the Quran. All the understanding was wrong. For example, all the mullahs in Egypt, graduates of Al-Azhar, they believe that Abraham's father in the Quran, who was a disbeliever, is not really his father, but his uncle. This is what I mean by they don't believe. They don't believe anything in the Quran. There are many other. This is because they built a theory that all the lineage from Adam to Muhammad are believers. So if Muhammad is a descendant of Abraham, his father could not be a disbeliever, as we're taught in the Quran. So one lie leads to another. So they refuse to say, even though, as you know, in the Quran, Abraham repeats, when he talks to his father, he keeps saying, "Oh my father, oh my father, oh my father, oh my father, ya abati, ya abati." But God knew that they will do that. Not once did he say, ya ammi, you know. Every time it's, ya abati, ya abati, ya abati. He never said, "Oh my uncle," once. Right. According to this. Yeah, sometimes you look at the English to understand the Arabic word. Because this Quranic Arabic, sometimes there are words that are not used anymore in our regular Tunisian Arabic or Egyptian Arabic. So if you go to the English, then we remember that. We know the meaning. That's okay.
Just a few days ago, we were reading Quran. We had a question about cross painting. Especially in Quran, I think there are some different meanings.
Submission?
Submission, for example, God says,
obedience.
Enter the city humbly, sujood, and not prostrating. But sujood means humbly.
Mm-hmm.
Everything, creatures, they make sujood, they prostrate God, but in their way.
You never saw a tree go like this.
Yeah, means obey. Obey, obedience.
Submit.
Yes, submission. Yeah. And there's a verse about Joseph's parents and brothers, they fell prostrate for him. If you understand in this way, that because only God, we shall prostrate only to God. How can you understand this? This is the question. How did they fell prostrate for Joseph?
Well,
this way?
No, Behruz was worried about his brother. And then he called him by phone, and his brother answered the phone, everything was all right. So as soon as he finished, he felt frustrated. He was really frustrating to God.
Okay.
So the same.
I gave his answer, but I was not sure.
When they met Joseph, they were so thankful to God that they felt frustrated.
The English?
They did not fall frustrated to Joseph, they fell prostrate before God, thanking him because they are united with Joseph.
But the English translation is, I think there must be a correction, before Joseph, instead of for Joseph, it is for Joseph, it's okay.
This is what the Arabic said, but your understanding must be that they fell prostrate thanking God. He didn't fall prostrate for his brother. He was prostrating to God and thanking God that everything is okay. But the Arabic says, وَخَرُّ لَهُ سُجَّدًا. سُجَّدًا لِلَّهِ. Same expression.
Also maybe Rashad.
So, but I'm translating the Arabic exactly the way. And if God wants some people to be confused about it, that's their problem. But you and I will understand that prostration is only for God, not for humans. There are some traps in the Quran for the unbelievers.
And I think this is a fulfillment of the dream.
Right.
The dream, sun, and the old planet. Old planet, they are prostrating to sun.
The sun, the moon, and 11 planets
prostrating to
Joseph.
Joseph now, I think, represents sun, because all these planets, they turn around the sun.
The sun represents the father, the moon represents the mother, and the 11 planets are his 11 brothers. They were all prostrating to Joseph. This is, in fact, this is in the books of dream interpretations in the Arab world. The sun means the father, and the moon means the mother, and so on. And it's taken from this.
But in the next verse he says,
he may be earth.
Don't tell
maybe
him.
Earth.
No, maybe nothing. He's just Joseph. Just in the dream.
Yeah.
A dream can have many representations. What if seven fat cows eating seven skinny cows? Or vice versa.
So he's telling him, don't tell your brothers. Surely the devil is man's worst enemy.
Yes.
So
because the devil will stir up his brothers against us. The devil drives wedges among the brothers. Okay, next time we'll meet at 7 o'clock, inshallah. For the night prayer. Salat al-Isha. If you miss the night prayer, we meet at 6 o'clock in the morning for the Fajr prayer. Thank you, Muhammad. We're waiting for you. Inshallah. A'udhu billahi min shaitan ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Quran is wisdom. It's just the subtitle provokes a short discussion here because people who are trying very hard to go to hell, people are storming the gates of hell and